Many thanks for keeping us company. This is Y254 News Highlights Discussion Monday. Tonight we talk about the state of the nation. We look at the few things that have been happening. A gold scam, the Huduma number, and a spare parts ban that brought up Roland. I'll be speaking to Kariuki Ngunjiri. He's a political analyst, as well as Donna Naklet. Habari yenu? Karibuni sana.
Thank you so much.
Now, last week we had a statement by Nairobi Senator Honorable Sakaja where he said, or he asked rather, is the government at war with the citizens? And do you think, Ngunjiri, I'll begin with you, do you think the government is at war with its citizen in regards to the deadline to Huduma number? Now we have the spare parts being banned from coming into Kenya.
Okay, thank you, Hilary. And just before I begin, let me acknowledge that some of the discussions that we have been having here have brought fruition. You just saw what the president launched when he launched the mortgage financing and refinancing fund, similar to what I had alluded in this same panel some times back. Your question is whether the government is at war with the citizens or not. The government is not at war with its people. The government is in a detachment with the people, because the government is a structure that is supposed to use various mechanisms as established in public policy, which then informs the decisions that a government makes. Therefore, public policy prescribes that a people that are going to be affected by a decision must be involved in the decision-making process. That is outright. And what you are seeing, and what Senator Sakaja has already said, is as a result of bad advisors to the state. Because today, I saw the president himself go to Embakasi and to those depots, whereby he ordered that they be released within 3 weeks. Therefore, a government is an organized system that has structures, and in that architecture, it is for the people who are given various duties in different ministries to advise the government accordingly. So they have failed the president, and in this case, and you saw the president himself took it upon himself and went to those depots to actually confirm and see to it that the containers are released. So my opener is the advisors of the state are not doing their job as they should be.
All right. Don, what do you think? Is the government at war with its citizens?
Yes, Hilary. First, I'd wish to appreciate our viewers. And secondly, I'd wish to pick it from your question. Maybe saying that the government is at war with its people would be a broader term, but yes, I think the government is at war with its people. My take on this is simple. There's a lot of issues that have come up, especially currently. We'd call them the current trends that are not merging with what the common Mwananchi thinks, or at least knows. Take Huduma number, for example. The decision to come up with a Huduma number might seem very noble, but how did we do it? The mobilization, the things that happened on the ground, and how it was hastened, how the people were forced to do it without necessarily knowing why they're doing it, what it is for, and the rumors surrounding it, religion and as such, really informs any public opinion that the government is not connecting to the people one-on-one.
Right.
So while maybe simply saying that the government is at war with its people might appear a little bit a broader term, but it looks so.
Right. Ngunjiri, the petition is still ongoing about the 1.5% revenue or the cut to the housing agenda.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one thing that also people feel like, is this government pushing us so hard?
Okay. I wouldn't infer that completely in that case, but I would, in a way, blame those that are supposed to make sure that public policy is indeed what the citizens want. If you look at advanced democracy, Hillary, you will realize that before the government does implement any policies, they are what they call town hall meetings. People are involved, and in cases you have heard of the leftist, rightist, and the centrist. That one means that there are people who have prescribed to a certain ideology. For example, farmers who would perhaps be opposed to a government's policy on ending or bringing, let's say, ending poultry farming in certain areas because of a certain disease. That therefore would inform the decision that government makes in agricultural policies in such specific areas. But in our country, and especially after the handshake, you find that politics, the political behavior, and the governance system has changed abruptly. You see that before the handshake, we used to have the government was always being checked. But as it is right now, there seems to be, power seems to be concentrated on one end. And as history teaches us, as it happened after the Weimar Republic collapsed, it is very dangerous. That was in Germany. It is very dangerous to concentrate power within one sphere. So my take on this is that, and I appreciate that the president did launch a fund that is going to ensure that even the private sector is involved in the housing project. But again, my reservations as it were then were the government needs not to force people to take that 1.5 housing percent house levy, because some people have houses. We have people who have already been servicing mortgages. Therefore, I sit at an angle that I believe that let government, and in this case, I have a problem with those advisors, because advisors,
and
be
it, truly you seem to have a problem with the advisors.
Yes, be it the ministries, because even in the ministries, they are the ones who are supposed to advise the cabinet secretaries and the state accordingly.
True.
But when they don't tell the state the truth as it is, then we find ourselves, because yes, we want to fight people who bring goods that are substandard in our country. But at the same time, we need a free market whereby any person who wishes to export second-hand machines or second-hand goods that are going to be used in our motor vehicles can be allowed to do so, as long as that person follows what is prescribed in the law.
Right.
We don't want to have a situation whereby cartels take advantage of that. Mm-hmm. And because we now have politics of 2022 and politics of superiority as it is right now, some people might want to fix the president or even fix the state in a way that people will say that the president is not doing his job. But again, these are people who are, I would say, another weird house of cards.
True.
Which is doing some things here and there to frustrate what the state is doing. So my take is, let those that are given the job of ensuring that there is good policies and they advise the government as they should, does their job accordingly.
All right. Now, Don, as you respond to the levy and the spare parts that were recently banned, but it was misquoted. They didn't mean the entire thing. But now, what's your take as a Kenyan?
Well, first I'd wish to respond to my panelist. I really think that when it comes to policies, before they are enforced, they need to be counter-checked. So entirely I won't blame maybe the advisors. Yeah, because look at the policies that came with the effecting Huduma number. They actually, the common mwananchi on the ground, until right now that the Huduma number is almost ending, does not even know what it is, leave alone what it is used for. So people just ended up doing it. Come again to the house levy that was just that has, let's say, issues with still in court. It came down to people that still don't understand what it is, how it is going, how is it going to be affected, and to who is it benefiting.
Sure.
You understand? So my take is, most of these the policies that we are currently having being affected by the government today, most of them we don't understand. And while I don't bring this down to the president who assents to most of them, still he has to shoulder part of the blames.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I think that I'm still holding to the view that...
You see,
hold on, you'll have the minute.
Yeah, you'll get the minute. I still think that before assenting to the bill, so even to the just repeal policies, we need to gather public opinion on it, even for a week. Yeah. Like the Duma number, it should have... The complaints should have been brought at least just for a week.
But don't you think if everything will be brought to the public, they will refuse?
Definitely they will refuse, but maybe they would bring their views on how they want it done. Personally, I really believe that the Huduma Namba, the digitization was so good. It was going to help in the security sector, a lot of things, identification. When you just do the facial recognitions, we've seen this work in the US, we've seen it work in most of the modern nations.
Right.
But how were the policies brought to where they are? They took processes and procedures. They were just not, somebody wakes up in the morning and then the evening once the police is affected.
So that's the only problem is they didn't involve the public.
Exactly.
All right, Ngonjuri.
Yes, you see, in any government system,
we have people who are called think tanks. For example, in the Ministry of Interior, which is responsible for the registration, because this is an issue of national security, we have those think tanks that sit down. These are different experts who will advise the ministry accordingly. They will be able to decipher, depending on law, depending on logic, depending on science and facts. So these are the guys who will then go to the ministry and tell the ministry the Huduma Namba process has some hiccups because of this and this and this. There is a problem in openness in this program. Why don't we go back and educate the people what the Huduma Namba is all about? So that one consists of the people who advise. In this case, they are not necessarily the normal financial, political advisors we know, but these are the guys who have that knowledge. And they are the ones who are supposed to now instigate that kind of a discourse. So when we have an open communication in a governance system, citizens tend to trust that system. When we have civic participation, and when citizens become a paragon of the civic virtue, or when the citizens become an excellence of that participation process, then in that case, we are able to say that there is openness in governance. The issue of public participation, it is at least in national government, we have seen that public participation is not being taken seriously.
Right.
That one I agree. So what needs to happen? The government needs to invest in an elaborate public participation process so that when such an issue arises, we also have a lot of uncertainties in the Huduma Namba.
Right.
You saw the president had to come out and at least try and verify and put some issues clear. That is not the work of the president. That is the work like we used to see in IBC when we had the issue of voter registration. We used to see the late Chris Musando address journalists every hour, every minute, telling them this is how we are going to do. And the government, IEBC, intends to register these people. This process is foolproof. Such kind of issues. You bring people closer to information.
Right.
That is the only way that you can be able to remove any doubt.
All right, I see you have a reaction. I want you to do it so fast.
Yeah,
we move
fast
to the next time. We don't have time, actually.
Yeah. You will agree with me that if we were to collect all the so-called government think tanks and advisors, you'll agree with me that the number is very, very less. Probably less than 1,000 across the whole nation. So all we are saying is, This nation has over 40% literacy level. People with at least
a
post-secondary knowledge. So we are saying that taking, say, the view of 1,000 people on behalf of 40 million Kenyans and simply rushing the decision to effect whatever you want is not good enough.
All right.
Yes.
Let's finish with what happened just recently, and this is a situation that will bring international problems, that is Kenya and United Arab Emirates, and this is about the gold scam. This is an issue that is ongoing, but still it will affect most of the Kenyans.
Yes.
It will affect the trade, it will affect our economy, because we relate with them economically in terms of what we get from them and what they get from us.
Yes.
What is your take?
Yes, that is true. Precisely. This is an issue of not only Kenyan government.
I want you to do it briefly. We don't have
yes,
time.
Yes, but an issue of geopolitical importance. Remember, when the president's name is brought in such a into such a discussion, then that one ceases to be just a small issue. But again, where did the president's name get into in this camp? We have some conmen who, in a way, because they have found themselves in a fix, will now want to use the handshake advantage. And now, because if you have listened to the phone conversations and how the conversations went, you realize that that is a politically motivated comment, that I don't know who has been told to meet the president, and then the president instructs the cabinet secretary. That now brings down our international relations course as a country, because if it is going to be proven that indeed there were people who were conned that gold, now Dubai, if it is going to be proven that they were truly conned, and that the gold will not be taken to where it was to be shipped,
right,
then therefore the relations between our country and Dubai would be compromised. And remember,
very fast,
there are so many Kenyans that work in Dubai to date. Mm-hmm. People who works as security guards, people who works as cooks in hotels, people who works in banks. Each and every day there are people who are going to Dubai to work there. So this could in a way jeopardize our geopolitical relations with the United Arab Emirates. And I wish to beseech the president and the involved agencies to disown these conmen. Let them undergo the full arm of the law. Let them be prosecuted because of creating a scam that will go in a way in history to jeopardize the relations that we have had with that country.
All right, Don, very fast, your final thoughts on this.
First, I'd wish to register my huge disappointment that the people that are assumed to have conned, or who are widely mentioned to have conned the royal family from the United Arab Emirates, are leaders. I'm so disappointed, secondly, that Senator Moses Wetangula, who was widely mentioned, has not resigned until now. That is one huge error. I really want to advise the senator that the fact that he's widely mentioned, he ought to have resigned and paved way for serious investigations. Secondly, our relations as a nation with the United Arab Emirates, it's not a secret. We all know that there are so many Kenyans on the other side, and we have those guys trading here. And such a thing, such a scam that goes into hundreds of millions, does not just affect two individuals or three individuals that are widely mentioned, the president included. It affects thousands and hundreds of thousands of Kenyans on the other side of the ocean. So I wish to bring my opinion on this, finally, that the people who are widely mentioned, especially if you're an elected leader, can you step aside? Tell the generation after you that you are a serious Kenyan that needs, that shows that you are a leader.
Right.
Once you're widely mentioned in such a scam into millions,
mm-hmm.
quit, and you will be brought back.
True.
By the same vote once you are cleared.
Right.
You are clean.
All right, we are out of time, Gunjeri.
Just a second. Before
we finish, I had heard a certain youth by the name Nyoike telling me that there is a lot of harassment in this city, and the city askaris are doing a very bad job when it comes to dealing with the people, even if they have offended, they have gone against the law.
You're speaking of the hawkers?
Yes. Uh-huh. Let the county askaris follow the law. That is what is due.
All right.
Nothing else.
All right, we're hoping your message will get to them. Many thanks for keeping us company. They have been my guest, Kariuki Ngunjiri and Donna Nacklet, political analyst. Now, coming up next is Uwai Mashariki. Stay tuned. I'll see you on Friday. My name is Dereva Hilary. Have a good night.
Y254. Imagine.